Jan, and also thank you to the organizers for inviting me to give this webinar. And I apologize for the delay, but my computer simply got heated up and nothing worked. Okay, so the title is Quantization of Moduli Spaces and TQFT. And here's an overview of the webinar. So first, we will discuss how quantization of moduli spaces of flat connections over surfaces is connected to topological quantum field theory. This will be sort of a panoramic overview. Then we will state and explain how this connection between quantization of moduli spaces and TQFT allows for the proof of many interesting results concerning quantum invariance using geometric techniques. And finally, we will present some details of work in progress with Jan and Pierre, concerning quantization of parabolic moduli spaces. Right. So we use the notation set lower k for the Witten Reshetikhin-Turaev TQFT at level integer level k in natural numbers. So this is a symmetric monoidal function from the category of cobordisms into the category of finite dimensional vector spaces over C here. And this is the mathematical model of Witten's quantum Chern-Simons theory with gauge cube G equal to SUN. So both on the physics side and on the TQFT side, we could take G to be a simply connected compact V group, but throughout this talk, we will focus on SUN. And historically, as I'm sure many here knows, this work by Witten was motivated partly by giving a quantum field theory interpretation of the color Jones polynomial of a link inside the free sphere. At least for n equal to 2, this will be the color Jones polynomial. For higher rank gauge group, it will be the color Humphrey polynomials. And by intrinsic, I mean in terms of three-dimensional topology and geometry, and not using the combinatorics of link diagrams. All right. So this TQFT, it associates to a closed oriented three-manifold, a complex number called the Witten-Reshetikhin-Turaev quantum invariant. And every free manifold allows a certain representation by a link inside S3. And given such a certain representation, we have the combinatorial formula for the quantum invariant presented here. The first line is the so-called framing correction. It's relatively simple. And then we have the second line where we see this sum over maps from components of the link into the numbers one up to k minus one. And then this product and then the colored Jones polynomials. So this is the formula for SU2. But what I want to highlight here is that I think that the formula is beautiful, interesting, but it has a complicated behavior as a function of k. Because when k grows, and this is what we're interested in later on, we are summing over this colorings of L, which, you know, it increases in k. So sort of the main point one of the main points of this webinar is that we can study this quantum invariance or these quantum invariants using the connection to Chern-Simons theory, and in particular the connection to quantization of moduli spaces. And this is further explained when we sort of focus on the two-dimensional part of the topological quantum field theory, which is often called the modular functor. So central elements of a modular functor is that to a compact oriented surface, S, possibly with some labeled marked points, the modular function will associate a finite dimensional Hilbert space, which we denote by set lower k of S. Moreover, it gives a projective representation of the mapping class group of S onto on this vector space, which we also denote by set lower k. In addition, for this to be part of the topological quantum field theory, there are many more axioms which need to be satisfied. So morally, it has to do with the modular function being compatible with cutting and gluing of two manifolds along long boundaries. Today, we will not focus on these surgery axioms. We will focus primarily on the construction of the Hilbert spaces via quantization and also the quantum representations themselves. So in the original work on Witten's quantum Chern-Simons theory, he presented two approaches to the Hilbert spaces associated to surfaces, both depending on a choice of conformal structure or Riemann surface structure on the Riemann surface. That is, depending on a parameter that we will denote by sigma inside Teichmann space, which we will denote by T lower S. So these two approaches were quantization of the moduli space of flat connections on S, which is identified via the Narasimhan-Tsuchia correspondence with the moduli space of semi-stable bundles on the resulting Riemann surface. The other approach, which I will not say so much about, is by conformal field theory. And you associate the space of conformal blocks to the Riemann surface. So both these approaches depend on this parameter sigma. And for this to be a modular functor, one must have in a suitable way that this should be independent, in fact, of this choice of sigma. And moreover, since they are modular functors of the same topological quantum field theory, they should of course also be proven to be equivalent. Okay, now we will review in more detail the quantization construction. Let me just keep track of time. So in Chern-Simons theory on a surface times R, the classical solutions is the space of flat connections on the surface. And this is in fact a symplectic manifold equipped with the Atiyah-Bott-Goldman form. To be more precise, that is, it's not a manifold. There are singularities at reducible connections, but if we focus on the irreducible connections, then this form is smooth symplectic manifold with the Atiyah-Bott-Goldman form. Moreover, it supports the so-called pre-quantum line bundle, which is a Hermitian line bundle with a unitary connection of curvature equal to negative I times the symplectic form. Right, so given a symplectic manifold with a pre-quantum line bundle, as discussed in Witten's talk earlier today, one way to quantize this symplectic manifold is to introduce a Kähler polarization and then take the resulting Hilbert space to be the space of global holomorphic sections of this line bundle. So in our case, to introduce a Kähler polarization, we use this Narasimhan-Tsuchia correspondence. Namely, given choice of conformal structure on the Riemann surface, this Narasimhan-Tsuchia correspondence gives an identification of the moduli space of flat connections with the moduli space of semi-stable holomorphic bundles on the resulting Riemann surface. And these moduli spaces have been much discussed today, and in particular they are projective varieties, so we have a Kähler structure. And then the resulting quantization in fact gives us a bundle, a vector bundle of quantizations, which we call the Velinda bundle. and it's the bundle we denote by V lower K over Teichmuller space with fiber at some convex structure sigma given by the space of holomorphic sections from the moduli space of stable bundles into the iteration pullback of the Chern-Simons line bundle. All right, so now we have a family of quantizations, and ideally this should be independent of sigma. And we'll explain now in what sense it is. So given an element F of the mapping class group of the surface we're looking on, this acts by a pullback on the connections. And in fact, this will be some pictomorphism on the moduli space of flat connections. And this pictomorphism, moreover, it emits a parallel unitary lift to the pre-quantum line bundle, the Chern-Simons line bundle. But also F shifts the conformal structure, right? That's the whole issue. So it acts on Teichmuller space. The above, I mean, in combination with the above lift, we get a lift to the Valinda model presented on the previous slide. A central theorem due to independently Hitchin and Axelrod, Della Pietra and Witten is that the Valinda bundle supports a projectively flat connection, which we denote by Napa and lower K, which is preserved by the action of the mapping class group. So in this sense, we should remember to state that Teichmuller space is contractible. In this sense, we have identifications of different fibers. So quantizations resulting from different polarizations within this family are in fact isomorphic. Moreover, we can define the quantum representation of the mapping class group to be the monochromy of the action and this connection. So now we've defined two of the central elements of the modular functor, namely using quantization, namely the Hilbert space and the action of the mapping class group via the monochromy of this connection, which we will often call the Hitchin connection later on. Okay. So for the other approach, it was shown by Tsuchia, Ueno and Yamada that the spaces of conformal blocks form a projectively flat vector bundle over the moduli spaces of curves. Laszlo subsequently proved that the quantum representations are projectively equivalent to the conformal field theory representations. And finally, Andersen and Ueno, they showed that this TUY bundle can in fact be refined to a full modular functor, which we denote by set CFT, which is isomorphic to the Reshetikhin-Turaev modular functor. So here I'm really simplifying a long and large story. And it also involves a skein theoretic construction of the Reshetikhin-Turaev modular functor due to Blanchet and Habegger and Massbaum and Vogel. Okay, so but for the quantization picture, we've mainly so far discussed the case of a closed oriented surface. But we have this theorem joined with Andersen and Pierre that quantization of the parabolic moduli space, the moduli space of flat connections on a surface with fixed holonomies labeled by lambda around the punctures labeled by P will also result in a bundle or also called the Valinda bundle over the corresponding Teichmuller space, which supports a projectively flat mapping class group invariant connection. It's also unique among Hitchin connections of differential order 2, but I'll explain this later in more detail. So let me say here that this was part of partially this was in the thesis of Medebier, who was a student of Andersen, but it will feature in a joint write-up with me and Andersen, which also contains some more general differential geometric constructions of Hitchin connections in the context of metaplectic quantization, and which we proved to work for this setting. Further, let me highlight a similar theorem due to Biswas, Mukhopadhyay, and Wentworth. I've simplified their main statement slightly, but it says that quantization of this, and the main difference here, I should state, is that the theorem drawn with Andersen and Pierre is for SUN, whereas this theorem 6 is for a general gauge group G, as mentioned in the introduction. And the statement is that quantization of this parabolic moduli space with respect to a family of polarizations induced from a versal family of pointed smooth projective curves leads to a projectively flat coherent sheaf on the base B. All right. Finally, concluding this first part of the webinar, let me address again that this is open problem of constructing the full modular functor from quantization, also for general Lie groups. And one strategy could be to generalize Laszlo's results. And in fact, there are now new theorems in this direction due to Andersen, Isgaard, Quintero de Rios, and Henke. Stated here for genus zero with arbitrary number of points and labels, the Belinda bundle and the conformal field theory, the Belinda bundle and the conformal field theory bundle are mapping class group equivariantly isomorphic and projectively flat bundles. So this is part of a preprint which is not on archive yet, but is to come shortly. Whereas all the other results are established and published that I've mentioned so far. So if there are no questions to this first part, I will go on to discuss these localization results and show how this quantization construction can be used to obtain results for quantum invariance. Okay. All right, so if we, focus again on a closed oriented free manifold, which we denote by M3. Then for each connection A, SUN connection here, we have this Chern-Simons action, which is given by this integral formula on the slide. The solutions to the Euler-Lagrange equations are the flat connections. So those that satisfy that D of SCS is equal to zero. Now the asymptotic expansion conjecture states, the precise statement is here, but philosophically it means that the Reshetikhin-Turaev, the Witten Reshetikhin-Turaev quantum invariant of M3 have a large level K asymptotic expansion in terms of exponentials of 2 pi I K, classical Chern-Simons actions, times a power series in 1 over K the level. So this is philosophically the large level K localization to classical solutions. And it's one of the important open problems in quantum topology. And many of the following results will be in some sense about this problem. The point is the following, namely that if we have a closed oriented surface S P lambda with points and labels, and we have a mapping class group element F fixing this data, then we can form the mapping torus by taking the cylinder of S S times the interval and close it up using F. And then the image of the map points P will give you a link inside this free manifold, and of course, the labels, as they are preserved by F, will give labels to this link. Now, the important formula following from topological quantum field theory actions is that the quantum invariant of this mapping torus will in fact be equal to trace of the quantum action on the resulting Hilbert space. And this means that we can study the right hand side of equation one using quantization approach. And this allows for more geometric techniques. In fact, we can apply both differential geometric techniques and in certain cases, algebra geometric techniques. And we will discuss both in the following slides. So first, let me highlight another result of Andersen, namely, the intersection of all the kernels. So it's called that. This result is called the asymptotic faithfulness of the quantum representations. And again, we have a surface of genus G greater than or equal to 2. We have a conformal structure, and we recall the quantum representation denoted like here. And then using the geometric quantization of the multiplied space of flat connections and triplets theory, we get the following result, that if you take the intersection of the kernel of the quantum representations for every level, then in the very special case that n is equal to the genus is equal to 2, it's generated by the identity and the hyper-elliptic involution. Otherwise, it's only the identity. So here's another result, which is due to me and Andersen. So we consider a surface again of genus G2. And here we have one point labeled by exponential of 2 pi I over n. And we have a mapping class group element which fixes this point. And for notation, we just set m to be m flat of sk, p, and lambda. Again, using geometric quantization, and here in the differential geometry techniques, we prove the following result, namely, assume that the fixed variety of f acting on m is a smooth integral manifold of the distribution given by the kernel of the differential of f minus the identity. Then it follows that for each transition action, there exist explicit smooth densities indexed by s and j in the natural numbers, giving exactly this large k asymptotic expansion of the quantum invariant in terms of classical solutions weighted by this power series in 1 over k. And here it's really more analytic tools. It's theory of Tupi's theory and the theory of Bergman kernels, and at the end of the day, stationary phase approximation. And I have a few remarks on this theorem, namely that we have a generalization when the fixed variety is slightly more singular, but cannot be too singular. Moreover, some similar results were proved by Laurent Charles in the case where, in addition, you assume that the fixed variety is finite. And subsequently, EOS computed also the leading coefficient of the expansion. And another point in using the quantization approach is that here, as with EOS's result, you can see directly how the quantum invariant computes classical invariants related to Chern-Simons theory and the moduli spaces. Further, let me comment that our result is actually a special case of a more general localization formula we prove, which we prove in the context of Hitchin connections on a more general symplectic manifold and quantizable symplectic morphism. And this is related to a classical problem, namely how to quantize symplectic morphisms. And in other contexts or similar scenarios, this has been considered by other authors, including Seldit and Volte and Pauletti. Okay, that's it for the differential geometric approach. Now let's focus on the more algebra geometric. So let's recall again we have a closed oriented surface of genus at least two, and then we have a torsion element of the mapping class group, which we denote by F. Then, since it's torsion, Nielsen's realization theorem asserts that there exists a complex structure on S, which is fixed by F. And this allows for the formula we see below, namely if we set Y equal to be the resulting Riemann surface, then F acts as an automorphism of this Riemann surface. And therefore the pullback action on the moduli space of flat connections, in fact, is a holomorphic or algebraic action on the moduli space of semi-stable bundles. And this, and it emits a lift to the Chern-Simons line bundle. Moreover, the Chern-Simons line bundle is in fact ample. So computing the trace is in fact equal to computing the sum of this alternating sum of traces on the higher cohomology groups. Because of Kudaira vanishing, all higher cohomology groups vanish. So therefore, we can compute it as this equivariant index of F. The point is that this is just a special case of the so-called Lefschetz fixed point problem, which is solved by the Lefschetz-Riemann-Roch localization, or a Thierbot localization in differential geometric context. And the statement is the following. So let G be a finite cyclic group with generator small g, and let X be a quasi-projective G variety. Let L be an equivariant line bundle, and assume that the fixed point variety of the action of G on X is projective and smooth, and introduce for each component of the fixed variety V, this notation nu of V for the conormal bundle, and lambda V for the Euler class of the conormal bundle. Then it holds that the Euler class of the conormal bundle is in fact invertible in K-theory. And we have an expression for the equivariant index of G acting on LK in terms of this integral of characteristic classes on the right-hand side. Okay. So I stated it here in the case where the fixed variety is smooth, but in fact it was generalized by Baum, Fulton, McPherson to the case where the fixed variety can be singular. And we need this because for the moduli spaces of flat connections, we have singularities, namely the reducible flat connections and corresponding to the semi-stable, not stable holomorphic bundles on Y in this case. Okay, but using this, Andersen obtained the following result. So let S be a closed oriented surface of genus G, that is two, and let F be this torsion element. And then again, for each Chern-Simons value S on the mapping torus, for each classical Chern-Simons value on the mapping torus, there exists a polynomial PS determined by Seifert invariance of the mapping torus, given an exact formula for this equivariant index. So here we see again that the quantum invariant is a sum of polynomials in K weighted by Chern-Simons exponentials 2 pi I K times Chern-Simons action. And this form conforms with the asymptotic expansion conjecture. And moreover, it was used subsequently by Andersen and Himpel to give gauge theoretic formulae for the leading order coefficient of these polynomials. Okay, and let me mention the special case where you take F to be the identity, then we compute, of course, with this, the so-called Valinda polynomial, which gives the dimension of the Hilbert space associated to the Riemann surface. And in fact, you know, historically, this is part of the reason why this bundle of quantizations we're considering is called the Valinda bundle. Okay, so this is the case for stable bundles. Now, a joint project with Andersen and Thomas Laszlo, we are generalizing this scenario to the case of the moduli space of Higgs bundles. So the setup is the following. Again, we have Y, which is a curve of genus at least two, a smooth projective curve over C of genus at least two, which supports a automorphism of prime order, of odd prime order, that is. And we consider the moduli space M lower H of Higgs bundles of rank two and fixed determinant inside the F invariant part of the Picard group of Y. So it's an F, so it's an F equivariant line bundle. And this moduli space supports torus equivariant line bundle, which we denote by L. And here the torus action is the same action discussed in previous webinar by Vicky, namely by scaling the Higgs fields. So the automorphism F, in fact, acts obviously on the moduli space of Higgs bundles, and it also has a lift to this torus equivariant line bundle, which commutes with the torus action. Therefore, F also acts on the graded pieces of the cohomology groups of LK for all positive integers K. And we denote these by H over Q, and then MH, LK, lower M. So therefore we can define this automorphism equivariant Hitchin index, which I've written here, which is a form of power series in T, where T is the standard character of the torus, or you can interpret it that way. And then our first result is that this is in fact a topological invariant of the mapping torus. So that's not so, I mean, it's not a priori clear from the algebraic geometric definition, but it's somehow something you would, I mean, it's from a TQFT picture we discussed earlier, it makes sense to guess this. But this is the first result that in fact, this automorphism equivariant Hitchin index will be a topological invariant of the mapping torus. So this is still unpublished, but we're in the process of writing it up. And in fact, we will eventually arrive at a explicit formula. So maybe let me say a bit about how we prove this, because it's again by some, I think, pretty interesting classical algebraic geometry. The first thing is we can localize to the fixed variety of the torus intersected with the fixed variety of the automorphism F. And for a fixed, so there's sort of a two-layer localization in this formula. So we start with taking a component M alpha of the torus fixed variety. Inside that component, we look at the F fixed variety. And we take a component there, which we denote by M alpha beta. Now we introduce the notation N lower alpha for the normal bundle of M alpha in MH. And we decompose that into positive and negative weight spaces according to the torus action. Then we introduce the notation N alpha beta, which is the cotangent, the conormal of M alpha beta inside M alpha. And then we take the Euler class of that. Having introduced this notation, we arrive at this formula for in theorem 13 for the automorphism equivariant Hitchin index. It's the sum over all components M alpha beta, and then this Chern class is the equivariant Chern class with respect to T times the group generated by F, and we have these characteristic classes in here, where S denotes the operation of taking sum of all symmetric powers. Okay, so first step is the reduction to this sum of integrals over this fixed point variety. So let me maybe give some of the ideas of why it will be a topological invariant in the end. So first of all, the ciphered invariants of the mapping torus can in fact be described in terms of the branching data of the associated covering of curves, pi from y into y over f, which is a projection. And in this case, since p is of prime order, the branch points will in fact be the image of the fixed points of f. Now, the first fact we use is that we can look at, we can localize sort of to the quotient Riemann surface, in a sense, loosely speaking. So as was recalled in the last webinar, components of the T-fixed variety of the moduli beta fixed bundles are given by the stable bundles, which we denote by NY, and the so-called type 1-1 components, which we denote by FM, which contains Higgs bundles where the vector bundle is the sum of line bundles, say L1 plus L2, and then the Higgs field maps from L1 into L2 tensor K, and you have a global section of L inverse times K times L2, and then you take the degree of that, and that gives you M. So that's how these components FM are built. Okay, so looking at the slide from the previous slide, there are two types of integrations that we need to do, namely the stable bundles integration and the type 1-1 integration. And if you focus first on the type 1-1, on the stable bundles integration, then in another work by Andersen and Grove, they showed that in fact the F fixed variety of the stable bundles is a disjoint union of parabolic moduli spaces over the quotient curve, indexed by beta here, the parabolic weights, and the parabolic weights will be in fact determined by ciphered data. But these parabolic moduli spaces are isomorphic to moduli spaces of flat connections with holonomy around the branch points given by conjugacy classes associated to these weights. And the resulting integral will be expressed in the Tiabat generators. And the integration on these moduli spaces of flat connections will then be topological, I mean, independent of the choice of conformal structure. And how am I doing on time, actually? I have 20 more minutes, or?
Well, you started 10 minutes late, so you have 7 more minutes.
Okay. So let me skip the type 1-1 integration, but it's, It comes down to the fact that these FMs are principal Jacobian, two torsion point Jacobian bundles over symmetric powers of the curves. And we have to pull back some MacDonald polynomials. Let me skip that. It will be too fast. So as we also have this stable bundles part, we also obtained some results just for the moduli spaces of stable bundles. So here, NY is the moduli space of stable bundles on, let's say, the total space of this covering of curves. And NY over F is the moduli space of stable bundles over the quotient curve. And we pick some suitable fixed determinant, which ensure smoothness by conformality conditions. The first theorem then is that in the Galois case where there's no branch points, then in fact the automorphism equivariant index on the moduli space of stable bundles on the total space of the covering is simply the Valente polynomial on the moduli space of stable bundles on the quotient curve. So this is a elegantly looking, I think, formula which we were happy to discover. And then moreover, we can also consider the quotient of the moduli space itself by F. So now we have the moduli space over Y, the moduli space of stable bundles over the quotient curve Y over F. And then we have the third component, the moduli space of stable bundles on Y divided by F. And the corollary 15 here gives a relation between the Hilbert polynomials of the associated line bundles. Yeah, it's a linear relation. Okay, so that's it for localization results. Let me maybe quickly mention then how the quantization of parabolic moduli spaces run. So here we pass to metaplectic corrected quantization. And the main point is that for a Kähler manifold with a square root delta of the canonical bundle and a quantum bundle L, metaplectic corrected quantization gives the Hilbert space, which is given by holomorphic sections into LK tensor delta. So for the moduli spaces of flat connections on a closed surface, we have that the first joint class of omega is proportional to omega, is equal to n times omega. And this is in fact used for the Hitch connection in geometric quantization, but it is not satisfied in general for the parabolic moduli spaces. And in this parabolic case, we joined with Andersen, we construct a projectively flat Hitchin connection in a more general context of metaplectic quantization, which we then show applies to the moduli space of flat connections with this holonomy conditions on the punctures. Okay, so first, for a metaplectic structure, we need a square root of the canonical bundle. Again, let's start with the labeled surface SP lambda. Then we have a pre-quantum line bundle over the moduli space of flat connections with lambda holonomy around P. And then the statement is twofold. First, for lambda ASUN labeling of P, the following holds. If we take lambda check to be a lambda plus the Y vector, then the canonical line bundle of the moduli space of stable bundles with this lambda check labeling admits the square root. And secondly, for each sigma in a Teich Miller space, we have an isomorphism of metaplectic quantization Hilbert space of this lambda check with just geometric quantization Hilbert space of the moduli space labeled by lambda. And moreover, this induces an isomorphism of vector bundles over the Teich Miller space. So this modulo some technicalities pertaining to propagation of vacua that I will have to skip shows that we can consider metaplectic quantization instead and try to construct a Hitchin connection in this scenario where we have a family of Kähler structures. So let me review the general setup. We have a pre-quantum line bundle on a symplectic manifold M comma omega with vanishing second Stiefel-Whitney class, and we have a metaplectic structure which we denote by delta. Then we have a family of polarizations, J, parameterized by a complex manifold denoted by T, like Teich Miller space, with complex structure I. We write M lower sigma for the resulting Kähler manifold. And we can pull back this delta to get a family of square roots of the canonical bundle of M. What is a Hitchin connection? A Hitchin connection is a connection on the bundle with fiber given by smooth sections into LK tensor lambda check sigma for all sigma in the T, which preserves the bundle of quantizations and for which there exists a one form on T with values and differential operators on this line bundle such that the connection is of the form lambda hat plus alpha, where lambda hat is a connection on the bigger bundle, which is induced by the connection on LK and the family of Levi-Civita connections on M. With this definition of a Hitchin connection, we can also define the order of a Hitchin connection to be the order of the differential operator alpha. Then there's an existence result by Andersen, Gammelgaard, and Magnus Rode, which shows that under certain conditions, which are stated here, and which I guess I will skip for today, then there exists an explicit Hitchin connection of order 2. Okay, and then we show the following result. If we define a Hitchin connection to be local, if for each open submanifold U, it preserves the sub-bundle of smooth sections from U into LK tensor delta, given by holomorphic sections over U. So this is a now bigger constraint because on general open non-compact subset, we will have infinitely many holomorphic sections. But the Hitchin connection that was previously constructed is given by differential operators, so it will have this property. So we make the following cohomological assumption that for L equal to 1 up to n, the following maps are injective, which are stated here, which is capping with this AL given in terms of omega, the symplectic form, and the first Chern class of omega. Then, if n is sufficiently large, namely bigger than 2m minus 1, any local Hitchin connection of order at most m is projectively flat, and two, any two local Hitchin connections of order at most n are projectively equivalent. So that's the general differential geometric statement, and we use this as we apply this, we can apply this to quantization of these parabolic moduli spaces. So this is the final result I'll state today, joined with Andersen and Bier. So we have again a labeled Mach surface. The first part is that the family of Cayley structures on the moduli space of flat connections, parametrized via the Mistegaard theorem by Teichner space, satisfy the above conditions. Furthermore, the resulting projectively flat Hitchin connection is preserved by the action of the mapping class group. Thank you.
Okay, so let's thank William for his talk. So, questions? So maybe I have a question. So could you maybe expand on why this why one should expect that this equivariant character over the Higgs bundle moduli space you talked about in the middle of the talk is a topological invariant of the mapping torus?
Let's go back to that slide. Right. So one way of thinking about it is that via non-abelian Hodge theory, this moduli space of Higgs bundles is in fact the moduli space of SLN 2C connections the non-abelian Hodge theory, the moduli space of Higgs bundles is the moduli space of flat SLN2C connections on the underlying topological two-manifold of Y. And this line bundle, if you take sections of that or the virtual vector space of higher cohomology, this presents then a quantization of this moduli space. And then you could naively think of this character as an SL2C quantum invariant. And there are various approaches to topological quantum SL2C Chern-Simons theory. One is by Andersen and Keshaev in the math literature with this quantum Teichmuller TQFT. But it's not defined for all closed oriented free manifolds. And in fact, as I remember this, these mapping tori of finite order mapping classes are not constructed. So we cannot compare with that, but that would be one explanation in terms of quantum SL2C Chern-Simons theory.
Yeah, and I suppose that what we're really expecting is that somehow there will be a full SL2C quantum Chern-Simons theory, right? And then in some form or another, this here is then the quantum invariant for that, for yeah. this moratorium.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So maybe I should mention here that so as was all, I think it was also mentioned, it was mentioned in both the previous talks today, this moduli space of Higgs bundles is the hyperkähler. And here is which we consider the complex structure commonly called I. If you turn on complex structure J, then this Hilbert space should be related to this so-called set hat invariance of Gukov, Putov, and Wafa, and Pei. But this is for another polarization, but yeah. It's another approach to SL2C Chern-Simons theory, SL2C theory.
So can you say again how general this setup is? So here you're looking at some specific elements in the mapping classical. And then there you see that you can define this invariance. But do you think that this can be made more general, like with arbitrary elements in the mapping classical? Yeah.
So there are two reasons for doing rank two. So one is that this localization formula here is always valid. I mean, we can define this quantity for general rank n. Then this formula here on theorem 13 is still valid. But then we come to the parametrization of, remember, it's all two layers. And then we come to the parametrization of the torus fixed variety of the moduli space of Higgs bundles. And then in rank two, it's very concrete and explicit. And we have the stable bundles. And here it's easy to see that, or I mean, it's not easy, but we know how to prove that the relevant integral is in fact something which is computed without reference to the complex structure on Y and given in terms of cipher invariance. And then there are these other type 1-1 components. And here in rank two, they're easy enough to describe. And they are these principal bundles over symmetric powers of the curve. But when you turn on a higher rank, parametrization of these becomes much more complicated. And it's not so clear to see, at least not for me, the topological invariance. So that's the first part that just to get something for the parametrization, it will get harder for high rank. Second reason is that here in rank two, we can actually get explicit formula at the end, which we also like.
But maybe I can add, if you go one slide forward, sorry, I guess two slides back then. Whoa, you went a lot back.
No, I went forward.
Yeah, go back, please, to the formula. That's, yeah. One more. Yeah. So I just wanted to add to Duke's question that, of course, this is highly sensitive on F being finite order here.
Yeah.
So if F is not finite order, I don't think we have much of an idea of proving this thing here.
No.
So it's very sensitive to F being finite order at the moment.
Right.
But of course it could be somehow, I mean, well, to define the left-hand side would already be, I mean, to define this quantity here would already be a challenge if F is not finite order, right? Because it doesn't have a fixed point in time space. And so we can't use all this algebraic geometry to compute and sketch it and define it.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the answer.
You're welcome.
Any more questions? Okay, so maybe we should thank William again. And in fact, all the speakers of today. And then I guess we reconvene tomorrow at the same time, 1500 hours at the UTM. And we start tomorrow again at that time. So thank you for now and see you all tomorrow, hopefully.